So yeah, it's I've been here at the UCLA Center for Health Policy Research since 2016, and it's been my pleasure to be the director of the CHIS, or the California Health Interview Survey. Survey methodology, survey data collection has been my career passion. I did my education in statistics, and as soon as I graduated, I started working for the U.S. Census Bureau on many of their household surveys, for a while working on their consumer expenditure survey, the current population survey, which produces the unemployment statistics. But the vast majority of my time at the Census Bureau was on the American Community Survey, or ACS. And it's been a pleasure to come to UCLA and work on the CHIS. So many of you may be aware of the CHIS, but for those who aren't, I'd like to give you a little bit of background information about it. So it really is California's go-to place of reference for local population-based health data. And it's really designed to democratize access to the data and provide it in easily digestible formats in such a way that we really can support decision-making across the state. Now, the majority of our funding for CHIS comes from different state organizations, and they use the CHIS to be able to support their decision-making for surveillance of their various public health indicators, as well as for service and program planning, development, and evaluation, depending on what their needs are. The content on the survey fluctuates a little bit from year to year to be up to date with what programs they're trying to implement. Then there are a set of core indicators that we tend to retain year after year. But then it's also our goal to really make the data available for grassroots evaluation and advocacy for anyone in the state. So it's a very useful tool, and we provide a lot of access to our data. And it's really one of our key missions as well to look at disparities. To understand and measure those needs and the disparities characterized by ethnic, geographic, and social class diversity, et cetera. We're constantly releasing new publications that examine the various CHIS indicators through a lens of disparities and through social determinants of health. It's really been a pleasure to meet these goals and objectives through the CHIS. In addition to our state government funders, we also are funded through various California and national foundations and other organizations, individual health systems, hospital systems. Occasionally we'll fund the inclusion of questions on the CHIS that are necessary for them to understand how to implement their programs and best meet the needs of their communities as well. In addition to the state agencies that use our data, county health departments also receive data files from us for their counties that help them to understand their local needs. It's also widely available to academic researchers and students. As a UCLA product, we're happy to support the work of students and other researchers in understanding our data and analyzing it. We also work closely with a lot of advocacy groups and CBOs who want to really advocate for improvements or funding or change to address some of the needs that are raised through the CHIS. I will state though that we do not currently focus the efforts of the CHIS on the group quarters population. So we do not include those in correctional facilities, nursing homes, or even certain college dorms. So it really represents the non-group quarters population in California. At the link here at the top of the slide is a document called CHIS Making an Impact 2020. And I encourage you to take a look at that at your convenience, but it's a rich document really describing how CHIS data have moved the needle in various state programs, how the data have been published in various journal articles and other publications. This middle section here shows, you know, just some key metrics about how some of our data dashboards have been used, media mentions, how they've been used by a variety of different media sources, and then social media as well, but also for various legislative and government impacts. So it's been used, CHIS data have been used, it seems like every year, in some sort of US federal court documentation. The California Health Benefits Review Program, or CHBRP, relies heavily on CHIST data for their legislative analysis, and there's a number of bills that were cited in which that occurred in the past year. And as well, it's a key driver in the California Simulation of Insurance Markets, or CalSIM, micro-simulation tool, which is also used to understand the impacts of the Affordable Care Act and health access, the Western Center on Law and Poverty, and a number of other institutions rely on the CalSIM micro-simulation tool that CHIST data fuel. So if you're interested in understanding in what ways CHIST has impacted the state of California and the nation, I encourage you to check out that document. All right, so who do we interview? The CHIST has a bit of a unique model in that we sample addresses, but then within those households, we select one adult, age 18 plus, for a detailed interview. We do that through the next birthday method as a pseudo-random means of selecting one adult in the household. And then if that household is the parent of any children or teens, we would select one adolescent age 12 to 17 and up to one child age 0 to 11. We collect the data for the adolescents directly with the parents' permission. We collect the data about the child through their parents as proxy. And the sequence of the data collection process involves starting with a brief screener interview for the household to make sure that we've got an eligible household and have selected the correct sample adult, and that we understand the characteristics about eligible adolescents or children in the household. Then we transition to a series of detailed questions about the sample child. That's actually a change that we implemented in 2019, and I'll share more about why and what impact that had a little later in our presentation today. And then we switch to detailed questions about the sample adult. At the end of that sample adult interview, we affirm that we're able to have their permission to speak with their teen, and then we conduct a separate sample teen interview with that parent's permission. So there are multiple components of the CHIST interview with up to two different respondents providing information for each household. And we do this in a number of different languages, seven languages specifically: English, Spanish, Chinese, both Cantonese and Mandarin, Korean, Vietnamese, and Tagalog was the latest addition to the CHIST in 2014.
A question actually there. It's, you know, California is so diverse, as you know, there's so many languages. Obviously, I have a lot of people that speak Farsi in my clinic.
Sure.
I'm not going to be here. So I guess, is it based on the population that speaks these languages, or how do these be, are these chosen as the seven that it's given in?
Yeah, that's a good question. Certainly there are, you know, there's no shortage of additional languages for which there are needs in the state of California. From, you know, a perspective of cost and, you know, the cost, you know, just the balance of the linguistic isolation, excuse me, when you rank the languages by linguistic isolation for population across the state, you know, we have to draw the line at some point on that list. And this is where cost effectiveness has, you know, that trade-off has been determined to be effective. Even Tagalog, even though it's next on the list for prevalence of linguistic isolation in the state, we get very few interviews in Tagalog. We feel like we've struck a reasonable balance at this point.
Makes sense.
All right, so geographically speaking, our sample design is ultimately designed to produce statistically reliable direct estimates for most counties in the state where the population within the county supports it. And we also want to be sure that we can produce direct estimates that are reliable for all the major racial ethnic groups, as well as many ethnic subgroups across the state. And so we use a pretty complex sample of about 20,000 adults in California every year in a number of different strata. So, there are actually two counties for which we go below the county level. Los Angeles County, we go down to the service planning area level, all eight of those. And for San Diego, we use the six health regions. So we do produce direct estimates for these sub-county areas in those two counties. And then otherwise we produce direct estimates for the 39 next most populous individual counties, excluding LA and San Diego. And then for the other 17 counties that have the smallest population in the state, we've actually grouped those into three multi-county strata for sample design and for estimation purposes. And this has been pretty stable with the CHIST since its inception in 2001. What has not remained stable is our modes of data collection. And so I'm going to describe for you first a refresher. If you knew the old CHIST, what we did from 2001 to 2018, how it was conducted, and then I'll describe how we evolved into something different starting in 2019. So the original CHIST contained two separate random digit dial telephone samples. So our mode of data collection was entirely by telephone, and we used a blend of both landline and cellular phone numbers. Over the years, starting in 2007, we added those cellular phone numbers. Then over the years, we increased the rate, the proportion of the sample that came from the cellular frame. And then we had to supplement that with certain ethnic oversamples. Primarily Koreans and Vietnamese had the most consistent ethnic oversampling across the different CHIST cycles. We used different tools to do that, whether it be a surname list or through geographic targeting. But we really had to put some effort, extra effort into those two populations, especially. This design had a number of challenges. First of all, response rates for household surveys across the board are declining over the years, but none more so than for telephone surveys. And that's primarily, I have listed here as, you know, cultural shifts in telephone usage and increasing challenges with cooperation by telephone. So, I mean, if you think about how you use your phone today versus how you used your phone 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, you know, it's no longer an exciting thing for a survey research firm to call, you know, the landline house phone on the hallway wall and talk to mom and dad and you know, get the interview. As we've transitioned to first the implementation of caller ID, then additional call blocking tools and call screening technology, many of us do not answer the phone unless we know who it is who's calling. And so the prospect of conducting telephone surveys as we had for many years was just no longer becoming viable. That really led to some ballooning costs to maintain the design of the survey. And that was no longer going to be sustainable for the CHIST. And you know, we needed to find a way to become viable for the long term. Additionally, there are other frames that provide better coverage than a telephone number frame, a random digit frame, random digit dialing frame. Not everyone has a phone number. Phone numbers are, it's more and more challenging now as people take their phone with them, their mobile number, out of state, out of different areas. And so to try to target geographic sample based on phone numbers was becoming a losing battle as well. There's some great publications, Pew, task force meeting on this report has a great summary of these challenges of telephone survey data collection. So as I arrived at CHIST in 2016, and you know, given my history working on a multi-mode survey, which is the American Community Survey, we knew that right away it was time to do the work to reinvent the CHIST so that it could be viable for the long term. So we started in August of 2017, initiating a redesign working group where we convened a number of survey methodology experts, as well as some of our key stakeholders on the CHIST, some of our data users, to make sure that as we considered options, we were considering best practices, but also going to meet the needs of our data users. We received some funding from Kaiser to conduct an initial experiment in the spring. Now, let me acknowledge that many people have to make changes in research design without the benefit of an independent experiment to prove in new methods before they make those switches. And we were so lucky to have this funding from Kaiser. It enabled us to do this spring experiment in parallel with our 2018 data collection using the old RDD design. So we had benchmarks then that we could compare to each other, and I'll show you some of what we learned from those comparisons. As we did the spring 18 experiment, we proved that our change in design could be viable. We also learned that there were some areas that weren't working very well and that we needed some revisions to the plan. And we were able to obtain additional funding from state general funds that came through the Department of Healthcare Services to conduct a second experiment in the fall of 2018. That fall experiment allowed us to tweak our experimental design, but also allowed us to conduct it statewide so that we could really assess the impact of the design changes across the board. Based on the results of that test, which we were able to analyze in early 2019, we selected our, finalized our methods for the new design. And then in the spring, we awarded a data collection contract and began data collection for the 2019 CHIS under the redesign methods in just a 3-month period for the full year. So normally, one of the other drawbacks of a telephone survey is it takes a long time unless you have a huge staff. To get to 20,000 interviews. And so the redesign also allowed us to be more nimble as needed for this year of transition. All right, so what were our new design, or what were the new methods of our new design? We switched to a mixed mode approach starting in 2019 with two different phases. We knew that a single approach in California would not meet the needs of all of the diverse population of our state. And so using a multiple mode approach allows us to use the modes that are less expensive and wide reaching first, and then transition to more expensive follow-up modes after. So the first mode was a push to web, where we sent up to 3 mailings to individual addresses that were selected for the survey. And in the mailings, we said what the survey was about and asked for the adult with the next birthday to go online and complete a survey by web. If they don't have internet access or they would prefer not to complete the survey by web, we provided a toll-free number for them to make an inbound call and conduct the survey. So we tried this for these 3 letters. We wait about 2 weeks between each of those mailings. And so after about 6 weeks, when this process had run its course, we would then try to match the address to a telephone number using commercially available services to do so. And if we were able to match a phone number to that address, then we would start outbound telephone calls from our call centers to those addresses to attempt to complete the interview that way.
Can I ask a question about the first step? Sure. Send out that mailing and it has the link, it has a link to the online survey,
right? Yeah, and a secure identification code as well, a secure access.
Is it a long link, I mean, to type in, or I just, because sometimes that's difficult for people. Do you have a real short link? Or?
Yeah, we abbreviated that link and tried to make it as user-friendly as we could. We did some usability testing in a lab setting prior to implementing the first experiment to confirm that people could follow the instructions on the letter. You know, even how you put in the secure access code was important in how you format that in the letter. So yeah, all of those design choices are very important.
And are you going to tell us later about the response rate by mode?
I will share with you right now that of all of the responses that we received, 90% came in by web. And of the 10% that we obtained by telephone, 5% were inbound calls and 5% were outbound calls. So we were thrilled that we were able to obtain so much data by web. It's the least, you know, expensive method. We could introduce certain quality assurance measures within the web questionnaire. And then the volume of inbound calls surprised us a little bit, that half of the overall telephone response was coming from inbound calls. And, you know, that's also much more cost effective than the outbound telephone calls. So we were very happy with that response as well. And as you, I'll show you in a few slides, as you would guess, you know, it generally tended to be older respondents who preferred to respond by telephone. So what else did we see? So in the first In the first test especially, but also in the second test, we found increases in response rates relative to telephone interviewing alone. But we saw sharp declines in that initial experiment for our teen response. So we knew that we hadn't solved the problem for adolescents. Our cost analysis showed it was a huge decrease in cost per complete compared to the RDD methods. And as you would guess, we got a different set of people who would respond by web than who would respond by telephone. You know, which is truth? You know, which reflects our population better? Well, you need some of both. And that's why a multi-mode design is often the design of choice for household surveys currently. So the web respondents tended to be younger and therefore healthier. They tended to be better educated, have fewer foreign-born and fewer non-English speakers. They also were more likely to have children, which is important to our study. And so the CADI, the telephone follow-up, was really key to making sure that we had enough sample of those other population groups so that we could, you know, compensate and adjust overall through weighting to reflect the state more accurately. All right, this slide shows the fall 2018 experiment, so our statewide pilot versus the 2017 CHIS response rates by county. And so on the left, you can see, you know, those in the red are, you know, around 5% or less response rate. So, you know, pretty rough response rates. I'm working on the American Community Survey, which was a mandatory federal survey. We had about 98% response. So it was, you know, it was an eye opener to come and see, you know, response rates in some counties hovering around 5%. But certainly in the Bay Area, the telephone methodology wasn't working. Even in the Los Angeles area, it wasn't working so well. It worked fine in the northern part, the extreme northern part of the state and the Sierras. But then as you look at the fall experiment, moving into this web plus telephone environment, we had much stronger response in the Bay Area as well as in the metro areas in Southern California. The Sierras did remarkably well. We lost some response in Northern California, and Imperial County was a bit of a struggle under either design. So in general, we saw, you know, some substantial improvements that led us to move forward to implementation. All right, so as I said, we did these tests in parallel, so we have some information to compare what happened under the experimental design versus the old production design, the telephone design. And I'm going to show you some charts that use unweighted data for demographics, and then some other charts that show key health indicators, and those are weighted. So the circles are the web component of the experimental group. So not the whole experiment, which is the red triangle, but just those web respondents from the experimental group. And then the green box is the green squares are the production RDD comparison. So looking at the unweighted demographics, you know, we definitely see that the web only respondents in the full experiment tended to be higher for the middle age group. Older respondents tended to be more likely to respond under RDD, especially those 80 plus. We got a lot of 80 plus who were less likely to respond by web or in the full experimental design. But we also lost a lot of the younger adults, which was interesting. So less likely to, you know, respond to a survey for which they get an invitation by mail, more likely to pick up the phone at least, not very likely in either instance to participate, but low response overall. But and you can see the differences in education level. We had a much higher proportion of college graduates among the full experiment and the web respondents within the experiment, higher income distribution, and fewer Hispanics, more Asian actually. So one of the interesting things that's a challenge that's been ongoing that we're trying to resolve is we're struggling getting Spanish speakers to respond either by web or by telephone. But we actually are doing better with Chinese and Korean speakers than we did under the telephone design. So, and we're using various multilingual mail materials targeted to different areas, either emphasizing Spanish-speaking messages first or Asian language messages more prominently. So we're trying to tackle that through various techniques. And then if you look at some of the key health indicators, now again, these are weighted to compensate for some of those demographic differences that you saw in the earlier slide. We tended to find a healthier, so those who had higher self-rated health tended to be in the web or the full experiment, so lower reports of fair or poor self-rated health. We got higher reporting on serious psychological distress. Maybe that's a social desirability factor with being more willing to admit that in a self-administered web questionnaire versus admitting it on a telephone interview with a live agent, and delays in prescription. So, I mean, there were some changes, some movement in the comparisons that were a little bit easier to point to a possible explanation and others that were a little less intuitive. All right, so all of that was based off of the experiments that we did in 2018. But then after we collected all of the 2019 data, we had a full statewide sample of 20,000 households to compare to our previous CHIS. And we had an obligation to help our users understand the impacts on trending from all of the old design CHIS through 2018 through the redesign for 2019. And so we produced this evaluation paper, which is available at our methodology page on our website. But it really tracks trends for many of our key indicators and explores some of the differences that we've seen. So as I said, we know the new design brings in different segments of the population. In some ways, that's an improvement. In some ways, it's not an improvement. Sample weighting continues to be very important as you're dealing with fluctuations in who responds. We did feel based on this evaluation that data users will be able to trend most variables, but we did flag some variables that either had to be a total break in series for some reasons we'll talk about, and others that we encourage you to consider interpreting those trends with caution. So let's look at some examples. So the biggest risk of a multi-mode design is providing different stimuli to respondents who respond in one mode versus another. And in some cases, it was impossible to avoid those differences. So this screen shows us regarding our hypertension question. By telephone, we used to ask, has a doctor ever told you that you have high blood pressure? And that was all that the respondent heard as the question stem. We found over the years that there were a number of people who wouldn't answer a simple yes, no. They would say, well, you know, I'm borderline, or my doctor told me I'm pre-hypertensive. And so we needed a category for telephone interviewers to classify those responses. And so for years, we've been producing estimates of yes, hypertension, no to hypertension, or borderline. Well, as we transition to a web-based instrument, it's impossible to capture the borderline or hypertension or pre-hypertension without presenting it as a stimulus for them to react to. So the web version is below, and they saw the same question stem, but they had answer categories that included a distinct option for borderline or pre-hypertension. And so what we found is more people chose to select that option than under telephone, where it had not been provided orally in the past. So, and as you can see, that has an impact on the trends. So for 2019, you know, for 2015 through 18, we'd have around 1% of respondents selecting borderline, but that jumped up to 7.2% in 2019. And so we had to caution our data users to understand that, no, we're not saying this is a 6-point increase in borderline hypertension that suddenly manifested in 2019. It's an artifact of the redesign that we went through. So this was probably the most a glaring example where this occurred in the redesign.
So did you do cognitive interviews? Because if I see that question, I'm thinking, well, why don't you ask yes, no? And then if they say no, ask the second thing, borderline or pre-hypertension.
Yeah, we did do cognitive interviewing and usability testing of the web-based instrument. This was the design that we felt best about for this question, acknowledging that it does you know, it creates this break in series from previous years. All right, so where else did we see some improvements with our redesign? We certainly saw huge improvements in our ability to collect data for children. We have a whole methodology brief that explored this. I'm going to share a little bit about what the causes were, but we had been experiencing this onward, increasing drop, I guess I'd call it decrease, over the years from 2013 to 2018, losing almost half of our ability to, you know, collect child interviews. And with our redesign, we doubled it. And I have to tell you, in 2020, with families with children home during the pandemic, we increased it even further. So 2020 is going to look even better. But where did this come from? So there were a number of different methodological changes regarding our collection from children at play. The first thing that I mentioned to you, so one of the steps that we took as we decided our sampling plan for addresses was to try to model the propensity of individual addresses having certain desirable characteristics, and then making sure that we were adjusting our sampling rates of those addresses in each of those groups so that we could try to be as representative of the state population as possible. So not every address in the state had an equal likelihood of selection for the survey. If we felt that that address had a non-English speaker, or they had children in the household and some other characteristics were low income, less than a high school diploma, et cetera, we would increase the sampling rate of those addresses to try to make sure we got more households in the data. And our 2018 baseline was that 7.1% of our adult interviews led to a child interview. That's the blue section at the bottom. But we guess that we can tease out based on the experiments that we did that another 1.6 percentage points of that was due to the fact that we were modeling the likelihood of sampling those households in our sampling process. We also found the resequencing of collection about child data prior to adult data to have a big impact, 3 percentage points. Why is that? Well, people are always happier to talk about their kids than themselves. Parents often find, we find that to be the case. And so it's also a topic, it's more salient to them. And so they get more engaged to the survey process. It's also a shorter series of questions than the adult series of questions. So they get through a shorter section of something they're interested in, and now we transition to a long, boring section. Instead of, we hope they made it through the long, boring adult section, and then we tell them we're going to ask them more questions about their children, and they choose to break off. So that was a smart methodological change to yield 3 percentage points. And then we did find just the natural likelihood of households with children preferring to respond by web versus by telephone accounted for another 2.1 percentage points of the jump. So we almost doubled the rate from about 7% to almost 14% of adult interviews yielding a child interview. And you can see the methodology brief if you'd like to explore that in more detail. All right, I'd like to talk to you about adolescents and some of what we saw with them. Under the old telephone modes, we would ask the parent for permission, and then the parent would essentially pass the phone to their teen. And that parent would then, in essence, really be persuading the teen to do the survey for us. When we first did our experiments in 2018, we attempted these kind of, we got the parents' permission, but then we were attempting to contact the teen directly. And we didn't really have that nudge from the parent to get the teen to participate. And our response rates were terrible. And so in the later experiment in the fall of 2018, we used a nested mailing approach to try to replicate that parental handoff. So if the parent gave permission online, for example, for us to contact the child, we'd mail a package to the parent. And the parent said, included a letter, thank you, parent, for giving your permission. If your teen participates, they'll get $10 incentive. Provide them these instructions in a separate envelope. And so then they would pass this other envelope to the teen. And so they went, you know, it kind of led to this interaction that led to more persuasion on the part of the parent for the teen to participate, we think. It certainly did improve the overall cooperation rates. If that first nested mailing didn't work, we followed up with additional mailings to the teen directly, as well as texting the teen if we obtained their phone number, and then calling the teen as a last resort. So what did we see for teens? A similar huge trend, a downward trend going into 2018. The first year we implemented in 2019, a big jump, almost double the number of teen interviews. And then in 2020 with families home during the pandemic, we actually have had another huge increase up to 1,300 teen interviews this year. But in essence, what we're seeing is a bit of a trade-off. We're getting much higher permission rates from the parents, but much lower cooperation rates from the teen. But the net impact is a huge improvement in teen data collection. All right, I do wanna leave time for Q&A. So I will just share some things about some other special projects that are going on in 2020. We have three additional follow-on studies that were happening in 2019 or 2020 and beyond. Following up on CHIS respondents, a study of CHIS respondents born in Latin America or Asia, a follow-on study of respondents with disabilities or caregiving needs, and a follow-on study for tobacco control program for the LGBT and NHPI populations. And this coming year, we have an oversample of Latinos and Asians age 50 plus in four Los Angeles serving planning areas for Cedars-Sinai to ask some cancer screening questions. And a Latino youth study following up on the interview of Latino children of both immigrant and non-immigrant parents. So interesting little partner studies that go along with CHIS. Just another interesting methodological experiment we're conducting this year is, you know, the number one challenge for surveys where you're mailing an invitation for a household to respond is getting them to open the envelope. usability testing has shown this time and time again. And tricks to get people to open the envelope can have significant gains in response. And so you don't want it to look like junk mail, but you do want to get their attention. And so we're testing a window where a $2 bill pre-incentive in the envelope will be visible. So that as they look at their address, they'll see that there is money inside. And hopefully that will encourage them to open the envelope and lead to a higher rate of self-response. We continue to try to enhance our sample design to reach those harder to reach populations, whether it be, you know, improving those prediction models of household characteristics or using census planning database to predict language needs to route inbound calls directly to bilingual interviewers, as well as outbound calls, have that first call made with a bilingual interviewer in the right language. We've also decided to implement a small RDD supplement to the basic address-based sample design for this year using prepaid cell numbers. And this is really to try to target those young adults that were missing, Spanish speakers, and more broadly, all Hispanics and Latinos, as well as the Black population in California. So we're gonna use a combination of sample designs as well to reach all of those groups. I won't go into detail on this, but our results in 2020, luckily we were not shut down at any point. Our mail operations were considered essential where they were located in Pennsylvania. And so the mailings kept going out and our data collection continued through 2020. And we obtained a much higher rate of completes, especially during those early months of stay-at-home orders. And the numbers are listed there. Speaking of the pandemic, we have a number of dashboards that are available that I hope you have seen. The link to them is here at the bottom of the slide. Or if you go to our homepage, the Center for Health Policy Research homepage, and click on health profiles on the side and then select COVID-19 dashboards. We've got a number of different dashboards. We have ones that compare historic CHIS estimates for certain risk factors by case prevalence rates. This was the first product we released. And then for the first time ever, as we were in the middle of collecting 2020 data, we started producing preliminary monthly estimates from CHIS questions that were added about COVID-19 and producing interim estimates during the year. And so there's some great dashboards that allow you to compare things about COVID-19 symptoms and treatment crossed by things like race, SES level, even household size, as well as some mental health variables, as we looked at questions we added about impacts of the pandemic. So there's a number of different things here. We looked at conflict at home during the stay-at-home orders. So this was the first time we've really done this kind of real-time or quasi-real-time as we were conducting the annual data. And then once we had enough data from May through August, we created a May through August pooled estimate where we were able to go down below the state level. We combined each county into single or multi-county groups to ensure we could meet our minimal sample size. And then we allow you to pick the question, pick the topic, and you can cross it by SES, by racial ethnic group, by health variables. This one here is showing especially COVID vaccine acceptance or willingness to receive the COVID vaccine at the sub-state level by these different criteria. So I encourage you to explore those data. There are a number of other tools that we have available to access CHIS data. Our most powerful tool is the Ask CHIS system here in the middle. And let me, just in the interest of time, go through what is available in the Ask CHIS system versus the Ask CHIS Neighborhood Edition system. In Ask CHIS, we release all of our direct estimates. So down to the county level for most counties, sub-county level for LA and San Diego, multi-county groupings for those smallest population counties. And you can cross it in a very powerful way by a number of other indicators from the CHIS. If you want to get below the county level, we do produce modeled estimates all the way down to the census tract level, actually. The current data that's in there is the combined 2015-2016 data. We pool 2 years of data. We are on the cusp of releasing our 2017-2018 pooled estimates. That'll be coming out in early February. So keep an eye out for that. And then you can really, we have a number of users who use it, but really it allows you to create your own custom geographies too. You use those tracts, use a tract lookup tool. You can select multiple tracts and group them together, and it will create a pooled modeled estimate for you real time. To be able to look at small geographic areas for a number of different health indicators from the CHIS. We're also adding certain vulnerability indexes to this system as well. Healthy Places Index, different health vulnerability indices. So that'll be coming out in the next couple of weeks in time for the 2018 data release as well. And if you want to know how to use those tools, check out this link. We have some easy to use video tutorials that walk through how to use the tools and get you ready to go to use them anytime, anywhere. I had some other highlights available from what we released on our 2019 survey regarding older people in California, caregiving and loneliness. Looks like we're about out of time, so I will instead just leave it there and we'll pause and I'll open it up to questions.
That was terrific. Thank you so much for that comprehensive and really interesting presentation. So I think folks on the call, anybody with a question, please feel free to put it in the chat or go ahead and ask.
Thank you, everyone. This is Art. I'm going to put up the QR code while I have everyone here so you guys can fill out the evaluation. So thank you again to Todd.
Stop sharing so you can share the QR code. There you go.
Todd, you said statistically reliable estimates in the beginning. Can you say what you mean by that?
Ultimately, we try to target a sample size of 250 minimum per strata per year. Obviously the strength of the sample varies by indicators. Not every indicator is asked of the total population in each county. But the original sample design for CHIS was based on a minimum of 250 interviews per year for the lowest strata.
So that's driven by something like a standard error that you're targeting, or?
Right. So, and right. So they picked certain key indicators. I think things like the uninsured rate was part of that. And then they did power analyses to be able to compare one county to another. And that's how they determined that initial sample size. All right.
Thank you.
This was such an interesting presentation, Todd. I'd, you know, a couple of years ago, probably 4 or 5 years ago, I'd listened to a presentation about CHIS, and it's so fascinating to see how much it's evolved over time, and especially with regards to the data collection methods, and I think that's, and the usability testing, for example, you know, even, for example, getting to, like, getting people to open the envelope, right? Like many of us in research, we're trying to get people to participate in things. And so really interesting to learn about actually some of the techniques that you use just to you know, for recruitment. You mentioned, you know, I know that oftentimes CHIS does kind of partnerships. Like you mentioned, for example, that there were some special questions being asked about like cancer from Cedars-Sinai researchers. How do kind of groups partner with you? How does that funding mechanism work? Like, you know, if we wanted to do something like that in the future, how does that typically work?
Yeah, great question. And thank you for the feedback. So generally we operate about 16 months ahead of the next cycle. And we try to keep content on the questionnaire stable for 2 years to be able to aggregate to produce those pooled estimates for AskCHIS Neighborhood Edition down to the track level. So for example, we are just getting ready to go into the field now for at the end of February for the 21-22 cycle. And we started working with stakeholders on question development for that about, you know, October, November of 2019. So we'll be starting again this fall, you know, around November in preparation for the 2023 cycle, 2023-2024 cycle of CHIS. So we're happy to work with anyone who has an interest in adding questions. As long as those questions are aligned with our mission, then it just becomes a question of funding. And, you know, household surveys collected in this way are not cheap, you know, so it is, I don't have the cost per minute or cost per question at my fingertip right now, but, you know, it generally is in the hundreds of thousands of dollars to add, you know.
It's like federal funding, like there are people getting like R01 grants to kind of add some questions, that kind of level.
Yeah, that is certainly one mechanism. Again, we have a lot of state funders who have state funds to allocate. And then we have, you know, other nonprofit groups that have contributed to the survey to fund questions of their interest as well.
Very cool. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Hi, my name is Anna Choi. I was previously a Rick Marchheim scholar working on the CHIS data. Actually, I wish I had this great presentation when I started on my project. But my question is about using weights. So I'm using data from 2011 to 2017. Can you guys hear me? I don't know if my internet connection is a little bit shaky.
Oh, yes, okay. We can hear you. So you're using 2011, 2017.
And I'm using all the, and I'm using all the sample codes that's provided for CHIS through like appending and merging the data. So I'm actually merging this data, ACS data, through the census track level information through the restricted CHIS data. So my question is, when I'm running the regressions, I'm using weights as, for Stata, you have to use certain commands when you're using survey data. So I'm using that, but when I don't use the weights, I get totally different, I mean, not completely, but slightly different results. So I was just wondering what your thoughts are about using weights, and if there are certain exceptions as to when you should always use weights or not. I understand that for when you want to make representation at the state level, you need to use it for summary statistics, like the percentage of people who are rated self-rated health as poor or fair, something like that. I mean, when you're using summary stats, you definitely need to use weights, but I was just curious about what your thoughts are on using weights with regressions.
Yes, I would certainly use the weighted data in your regression models. And I'm posting in the chat an email address, dacchpr@ucla.edu. That's our CHIST Data Access Center. And for detailed questions about a specific approach that you're trying to use, feel free to email the specifics to that address and they'll kind of parse it out among our statisticians and make sure we get you an accurate answer for your specific situation.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Rock.
Hello.
Hi, just wanted to know if you mentioned that it's possible to access the data, but I wonder if it's just aggregate level data or also individual level data, because sometimes I'm doing some research where I like to have data, let's say from like 10 years, you know, prior and then into the future to be able to see like the impact of certain policies. I just wonder if it's possible to have access to data for multiple years and for also individual level data.
Yeah, great question. And unfortunately, that was one of the things that I flew over pretty quickly, just in the interest of time, but I'm happy to go back to it now. So in the CHIST data, so these bottom tools in orange are sort of the aggregate data tools that you have to be able to generate real-time crosstabs or look at profiles, summary statistics about the data. We do have a public use file available. We have both a single year public use file and a 2-year public use file. The 2-year, so that's record level data. So it does not contain a geographic identifier. So there's no way of telling, you know, where in the state that individual response record was from, but it does allow you, you know, be able to, you know, run your own analyses using record level data, individual data. And the single year and the 2-year PUFs both have data protections in place to prevent identification of individual respondents. The 2-year PUF allows slightly more disaggregation, especially for certain racial subgroups. So you can disaggregate a little further your analyses. But if you really want to know, if you have your own custom analysis in mind and it requires that understanding of the geographic identifier for that record, or it involves some of the most sensitive items on the questionnaire that we don't release in the public use file, you can submit an application to have analysis run on our data access center. So that's within our secure network. We run the data, we give you the outputs, but you can write the code, you can, you know, recommend exactly which variables you want to use, and then we work with you on that process. That also involves an application. There are some fees associated with that kind of work, because you're paying for our statisticians' time to run that analysis for you. But also, you know, if you go to the DACCHPR, if you send an email to them, they can help walk you through that process. Yeah, so hope that answers your question.
Yes, thank you.
So it looks like we're right at the top of the hour. I think that was really tremendous. Just wanted to say again, we really appreciate that. It's so useful to see this resource that is in our own area that we people have access to as junior faculty and fellows to maybe run things or at least get more information on California level health issues. So I wanted to thank you so much for coming and keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to talk to you all today.
Terrific, yeah. Have a good one.
Bye.
Thanks so much, everyone. Take care.
Thank you.